music in the night, a dream that can be heard. Isn't it romantic? Moving shadows right, the oldest magic word. I hear the breezes playing in the trees above, while all the world is saying you were meant for love. Isn't it romantic merely to be young on such a night as this? Isn't it romantic? Every note that's sung is like a lover's kiss. Sweet symbols in the moonlight. Do you mean that I will fall in love perchance?
Towns forever, back roads empty for miles. Well, you can't have a dream and cut it to fit, but when I saw you, I knew we'd go together like a wink and a smile. Leave your old jalopy by the railroad track. We'll get a hip double dip tip toppy two-seat Pontiac, so you can rev her up. Don't go slow, it's only green lights and all rights. Let's go together with a wink and a smile. Give me a wink and a smile. We go together like a wink and a smile. Now my heart is music, such a simple song. Again, the notes never end. This is where I belong. Just the sound of your voice, the light in your eyes. We're so far away from yesterday. together with a wink and a smile. We go together like a wink and a smile.
Give me a kiss to build a dream on, and my imagination will thrive upon that kiss. Sweetheart, I ask no more than this, a kiss to build a dream on. Give me a kiss before you leave me, and my imagination will feed my hungry heart. Leave me one thing before we part, a kiss to build a dream on. When I'm alone with my fancies, I'll be with you, weaving romances, making believe they're true. Oh, give me your lips for just a moment, and my imagination will make that moment live. Give me what you alone can give, a kiss to build a dream on. Imagination will make that moment live. Oh, give me what you alone can give, a kiss to build a dream on.
You must remember this, a kiss is still a kiss, a sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. And when two lovers woo, they still say I love you. On that you can rely. No matter what the future brings, as time goes by. Moonlight and love songs, never out of date. Hearts full of passion, jealousy and hate. Woman needs man, and man must have his mate, that no one can deny. It's still the same old story, a fight for love and glory, a case of do or die. The world will always welcome lovers as time goes by. Welcome lovers as time goes by.
Now my baby really loves me. And I tell him, gee, baby, gee, I really love you, gee, baby, gee. I'm dreaming of you every time he kisses me. I say, gee, baby, gee, oh, gee.
Thank you. the very thought of you. And I forget to do the little ordinary things that everyone ought to do. I'm living in a kind of daydream. I'm happy as a king and foolish. Though it may seem to me that's everything, the mere idea of you, the longing here for you. You'll never know how slow the moments go till I'm near to you. I see your face in every flower, your eyes and stars above. It's just the thought of you, the very thought of you, my love. Moments go till I'm near to you. I see your face in every flower, your eyes and stars above. It's just the thought of you, the very thought of you, my love.
Taking your picture.
is it possible for two people to live together for half a century? The answer is that there are actually many ways to do this, as many ways as there are couples in the world. And to tell the truth, there are some couples who make it by the skin of their teeth. They sort of schlep along, half conscious, and they trip and they stumble through life and their relationship together. And more commonly, couples settle into routines, routines of communication, of labor, of leisure, that allow time to take care of itself, and then how the years fly by. By far the rarest situation, however, is when a couple is perfectly matched, when the marriage is made in heaven, as the saying goes. It's in these rare unions between soulmates that we can glimpse what life may have been like for Adam and Eve in Eden, the garden of earthly paradise. According to the Torah, marriage is a gift from God to human beings, specifically designed for us, for our growth and our happiness. Sadly, for many couples, marriage seems to accomplish precisely the opposite of happiness. And much of the time, husbands and wives only share the same space, and they avoid sharing their time or their real feelings. Therefore, it gives me such great nachas, such great pleasure to stand here with Jack and Yetta as we celebrate their 50 years of happiness together. In Jewish tradition, the usual number signifying fullness or completion is 7. And there are so many examples of this. Shabbat, the day of rest and fulfillment, is the 7th day of the week. And the month of Tishrei, the month of the High Holy Days, is the 7th month of the Jewish year. But there's an even more extraordinary symbol in Judaism for fullness and completion. And that is the number that follows 7 times 7, that number being 50. 50 is the number of eternity, a number which sits above and beyond the 7 times 7 of worldly achievements. And so, Jack and Yetta, I want to say, first of all, that your 50th anniversary represents a conquest of the time and space-bound universe, as represented by the 7 days of creation. If we think about it, time is actually an abstract concept, which we can only measure by changes in the outside, changes in environment, such as the turning of the Earth on its axis, or the phases of the moon, or changes in our lives, such as the growth of children and grandchildren, and our own process of growth and maturation. Of course, these things are much less predictable than the sun and the moon. We can never really know how our lives are going to turn out. We don't know how our children and our grandchildren will grow up, or how long we'll be healthy, or how long our marriages will last. And so after 50 years, when our children and grandchildren have turned out just fine, and when we're still healthy and our marriages are still harmonious, that's something really to celebrate. It means that you've taken the natural tendency of time to change things and given that tendency a positive and wonderful direction. Instead of allowing time to erode your relationships or your health or your happiness, you've taken control of time and you've made it serve your purposes. So we might ask another question. How is it possible to ride the tiger of time in this way and force it to serve the purposes of life and health and happiness? In a word, the answer is love. Love is God's very special and powerful gift to us, a gift that allows us to conquer the 7 days of creation and enter into the time thus. In Jack and Yetta's case, that love allows them to be very natural and easy in their togetherness. Jack and Yetta are completely free to be themselves, they're free to be open and honest with one another, and they are free to disagree with one another. So the bond between Jack and Yetta these past 50 years has been a bond of freedom, a bond in which significant portions of their lives are unbound. Like a flag which freely billows in the breeze, the levitt relationship allows for plenty of movement and self-expression. But the other component of Jack and Yetta's togetherness is that they clearly understand what they cannot do, Harsh words, hidden feelings, irresponsible actions are out of the question. Jack and Etta understand that such negative behavior would break the bond between them. To return to our flag analogy, it would be like tearing at the bond between the flag and the flagpole. The flag would then lose both its stature and its freedom, since a flag torn from a pole falls to the ground, and a fallen flag can no longer billow in the breeze. So, a 50-year wedding anniversary is much more than an ordinary celebration. Like all truly great occasions in life, a 50-year anniversary is also an opportunity to learn. From Jack and Etta, we can all learn a lot about the meaning of life and how it's possible to add years to our lives as well as life to our years through the practice of true togetherness with another human being. Tonight, we're celebrating the full maturity of that 50-year love, which is now taking Jack and Etta into the 21st century, but also beyond the world of mere days and years, into the world of pure love, beyond all time and space. So I ask you to witness now, as I chant the traditional Sheva Brachot, the seven blessings of health and happiness and harmony with which Jack and Etta were blessed under a chuppah like this one some 50 years ago. Jack, Etta, it's the joy of your family and friends gathered here tonight that you have fulfilled the promise of those blessings in the course of those last 50 years. May you continue to fulfill them in continued good health, is under the sponsor for another 50 years of life and love and happiness. Amen. And speaking of Amen, we're going to be chanting some blessings now, and it is the utterance of Amen and your participation in the blessings which magnify their power tremendously and actually aid in their fulfillment. So I'm going to grab this kos yayin, this cup of wine, a symbol of joy in Jewish life, and we'll begin. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Borei pri form the fruit of the vine. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam shehakol bara likvodo. Amen. Holy One of Blessing, your presence fills creation as all of your creation reflects your splendor.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam yotzer ha'adam.
Amen. Holy One of Blessing, your presence fills creation as you give life to each human being.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher yatzar et ha'adam b'tzalamo b'tzel demuta ha'mito b'hikin lo mimenu b'inyan adeya. Baruch atah Adonai yotzer
reflecting the image of God for the other forever. Holy One of Blessing, you give life to every living being.
Sos pasis, betagel ha'akara, de Uspaneha, Letoha, Besimha, Baru, Hata, Harai, Misamea, Sino, Bevane. Finds that her children gather to rejoice within her. Holy One of Blessing, you make Sion happy with all of her children.
Sameya tisama veim ha'ahuvim kisamei tefayitzircha veganei demikedem baruch atah Adonai mesameach atah
in your creation of Gan Eden, the garden of earthly paradise. Holy One of Blessing, your presence radiates joy for the bride and for the groom.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher baratzas b'simchat hatan v'chala, asher baratzas b'simchat hatan v'chala, asher baratzas Ina, Rina, Dinitza, Behenva, Abba, Beyapa, Beshalom, Perehu. Ina, Rina, Dinitza, Behenva, Abba, Beyapa, Beshalom, Perehu.
Mehera, Adonai Eloheinu, Yishama, Yarimutna, Ubekutsat, Yimushala, Kol sason bekol simha, kol chatan bekol kava, kol mitzvot chatanim bechupatam, kol ne'arim b'mishne ginatam. Baruch atah Adonai, mesameach atah imchatam.
Chanted that last long blessing, the seventh of the seven blessings. Holy One of Blessing, your presence fills creation. You created joy and gladness, bridegroom and bride, delight, song, laughter and gaiety, love and harmony, peace and friendship. May all of Israel and all of the world soon ring with voices of gladness and joy, voices of bridegrooms and brides, voices raised in joyful wedding celebrations, voices lifted in festive singing. Holy One of Blessing, your presence radiates joy for bride and for groom. And I think that at this moment, it would be only appropriate that we reenact something again that happened 50 years ago. We have two glasses this time. So you get your chance. And as you prepare to break these glasses, I want you to keep in mind the special symbolism of the broken glass. Actually, there are many, many explanations, but I see the broken glass as a symbol of the work that we need to do to heal the world, and also a symbol of that very powerful instrument with which God has endowed us, that we are supposed to heal the world with, that most powerful instrument being love. There's nothing that can stand before it. And even though we live in quite a broken universe, we have the ability to perfect ourselves, perfect our relationships, to raise perfect families, which will be, hopefully, in our lifetimes, the basis of perfect communities and a perfect world. It's within our grasp, if only we begin with the first step, and that is with ourselves. So, Jack and Yetta, these broken glasses, they symbolize your challenge, Although in 50 years, I'm sure you've accomplished quite a lot of perfection. There's still a challenge for you. There's a challenge for all of us. And may your 50 years of togetherness, of happiness, of joy, of health, of progress and fulfillment be an example for all of us in creating a harmonious and peaceful world. And let us say.
Mazel tov!
The column. This is the special first dance, but it's actually in the second dance because it's 50 years later for the anniversary dance. You have a chance for you.
Thank you.
Dennis, what do we do now?
Now we are ready for...
Are we going to march in?
We're going to walk in.
So let's hear.
Ladies and gentlemen, tonight we come together as family and friends to celebrate some of life's most cherished moments, to pay tribute to two very beautiful people on the occasion of their 50th wedding anniversary. Yetta, Jack, please forgive us if you may be somewhat embarrassed. We come here to honor you and to share with you our happiness as family, as friends, people who care for you, and people who envy you for your happiness. Over the course of the evening, many of us will take the opportunity to say a few words in order to share with you some of the thoughts of congratulations and sincere appreciation for your gifts to us of happiness and friendship and love. We would like you to allow us to treat you, to flatter you, and to indulge you in our reflection on your lives through your eyes. So please relax, allow yourself to be pampered. Let us give you back some of the incredible kindness and love that you've given us over the years. I'd like to call upon Perry to do the Motsi of the Holland Monkeys.
He's keeping the jack in the evidence.
I can't see this.
I told him he did a good job.
Just before we begin the dinner, I'd like to pay tribute to some out-of-town guests, Libby and Irv from Sun City, Arizona.
Dresses up in the pink silk blouse she made in Home Ec.
and a lovely skirt borrowed from her sister Clara, and heads to the alley. There the cute boy spies the pretty girl, and so starts a love story that has lasted more than half a century. Today we are celebrating a milestone in that love story with the 50th anniversary of my parents, Yetta and Jack. I can hardly believe it has been 50 years. How did we get here so fast? Some of you might know that today is also my birthday. Let me say that I could not have wished for a more perfect present than for all of us to be here, celebrating this very special occasion. Mom is the daughter of Beryl and Tybal Manuk, wonderful parents who were devoted to their six children. When she was 10, Mom was chosen to live for a year with her Auntie Lily and Uncle Morris in Vista, Manitoba. Lily Morris owned a general store, and not having children of their own, wanted to spend time with one of their nieces. As I said, they chose Mom because apart from her being one of their favorites, Lillian Morris wanted to fatten her up. Now, they weren't the only people who had tried to do that. Mom used to walk to school with two friends, Shirley Neeson and Clarice Gordon. But my grandmother would often make them wait until Mom had reluctantly swallowed a raw egg before leaving for school. This too was intended to fatten her up. The move to Vista was initially difficult for Mom, being separated from her family and friends. But as is her true nature, she soon made great friends and still has wonderful memories from that time. Through this and the example of her parents, Mom learned the value of keeping family close, whether her siblings or her own children. And we dearly love her for that. Mom is a treasure both inside and out. Not only is she gorgeous to look at and wonderful to be around, but she is very friendly, bright, and has a warm heart. And she is without doubt the most organized person I know, with an uncanny ability to put her hands on anything and everything. In fact, just a few months ago, she was able to dig out the receipt from her wedding night at this very hotel. Qualities are the way she cares for everybody and that she never forgets a special occasion. You can always rely on her to send a card for your birthday, an anniversary, and graduation. Yes, even a mailman is on her birthday card list. Dad is the son of William and Molly Levin. My grandfather William was an artist in his own sign business. Dad was devoted to his parents and would do anything for them. And I mean anything, including climbing on the roof of a 15-story building, hanging a ladder over the side, and then climbing backwards down the ladder to fill in a sign that my grandfather had drawn on the side of the building. Now the really scary thing was that the ladder had no back support. It was like standing in midair. My dad is a man of great foresight and brilliance, and was responsible for many firsts in Winnipeg. He was the first to bring plastic signs to the city. Then, before he was 35, and with hardly any experience as a developer, he built the Courts of St. James, the first development of its kind in Western Canada. Dad was the first to convert an apartment building to a luxury hotel which boasted rooms 1.5 times the average size. He was the first to put video vending machines in hotel lobbies across North America and Australia. He also saw the future potential in many areas of the city and bought up land on Keniston, St. James Street, and downtown when there was very little development in these areas. The Winnipeg Skywalk system was also his brainchild. And the Lakeview family of hotels is crowning glory. What amazing accomplishments. I'm so proud of him. His biggest accomplishment, however, is being a warm, loving father and husband who always puts his family first. All the while, we were made to feel included in his work because Dad involved us, explaining his ideas with such energy and enthusiasm. He continues to astound me with his incredible vision. Mom has been a wonderful support to Dad from the very beginning. They are a great team, and she has stood by him through thick and thin, encouraging him, keeping things calm and peaceful so that everything runs smoothly. Although my parents and I are very close, I am more my father than my mother, in more ways than just our good looks and personal style. We've had to go together to several health spas in the pursuit of good, healthy eating habits. We'd have a wonderful time together, lose about 10 pounds, and then come back home and immediately start stocking up again, if you know what I mean. My parents are great travelers. Every Christmas growing up, our entire family went somewhere for at least 2 weeks. Israel, South America, Australia, a wonderful opportunity for 3 young kids. Even now, Mom and Dad still take off every year, and for the past few years have headed to Hawaii. But try as they might, they can't escape Darren and me. We always follow them, no matter where they go. Through their love of travel, I developed a passion for it. Yes, I even married a traveler. And Darren has his own flight logbook, clocking up an incredible 700 hours in the air. Pretty good for an 8-year-old. When they aren't traveling, my parents spend their time here in Winnipeg. They have lived in the same house for 30 years, designing and building it themselves, and making it big and strong enough with its special foundation and steel beams to house a bowling alley right there in the basement. Yes, for many years, there was that rumor going around. And although the basement walls are lined with dozens of Dad's bowling trophies, I can categorically state there is no bowling alley in that house, at least not the last time I looked. So where do I fit into all this? There's no doubt that I've been a source of distraction for my parents since the day I was born. Blonde and green-eyed, I didn't resemble anything thus far in the family tree. I didn't look like Shelley or Keith either, which didn't help at all. Then when I was a teenager, there was the room thing. My door is the only one close to public viewing in an otherwise meticulous house. The household subscribed carte blanche to the better close the door and forget what lurks inside notion when it came to my room. All the while, I reveled in my role as the eldest child. The bossy one, the organizer. Who chose the holiday destinations? I did. Who was in charge when my parents were away? I was. And who has never been able to cut the umbilical cord? Me. In fact, I've never even wanted to. Well, why would I? My parents are the best, and I'm not the only one to say so. Every person in this room is proof of that. That both my parents were extremely close to their parents accounts, in part, for my relationship with them. My only concern is for Darren. If it is true that the way you treat your parents comes back to haunt you, then I'm sorry, Darren, at this rate, you might never leave the house. My parents' legacy to me was an unbelievable childhood, strong family values, and the encouragement to be my own person. That legacy provided me with the one true gift that no one else could give me, the gift of setting a beautiful example of how great life can be when you spend it from early on forever with those who love you and with those you love. So, thank you, Mom and Dad, for your many gifts, your personal values, 50 years of love for each other, your unwavering love of our family, and for celebrating my birthday in the most wonderful way. Happy anniversary.
He wanted to see. He said something. He wondered. They were wondering what's behind
it.
Before I start my speech, I just want to say that when my mom asked me if I was just now saying a speech, she said, "Oh, don't worry. You're great at that." That is just the way she is. She is so supportive. Anyway, it is just so hard to believe that we're here celebrating my mom and dad's 50th anniversary. I'm not sure how this is possible, because I know that I'm still in my teens. Okay, I'm not delusional, but it does feel like yesterday. Time passes so quickly that before we realize, we are in a new stage in our lives. I'm sure that my mom and dad feel this as well. They must look back and remember so many memorable times in their lives. For instance, I'm sure that my parents can vividly recall their anticipation of the arrival of their second child. Just in case you're having trouble following this, that second child was none other than myself. My sister Diane was almost 4 years old at this particular time. Being a typical four-year-old girl, Diane was hoping for a little sister with whom she could play. On the other hand, through deductive reasoning, I would guess that my parents already having a daughter were now hoping for a son. I have brought this theory to my parents' attention on several occasions. My mother gives me a resounding no, following with this, "Long as you were healthy" statement. My dad remains silent, knowing when not to get involved. My mom and dad's responses and reactions are very different in many situations. The saying, "opposites attract," definitely has merit. First, there are the obvious differences between them, such as those in their mannerisms and obvious personality traits. Secondly, there are the differences in what each deems to be proper. My mother's standards are very different from those of my dad's. She wrote the book on proper etiquette. It really wasn't Amy Vanderbilt. I'm not so sure that my dad read the book thoroughly, though, during his ethics. Diane, Keith, and I have only read a few of the chapters. The third difference is in their emotional makeup. My mom is feeling-oriented, while my dad tends to intellectualize. My mom is always passionate in her responses. And although I know that my dad feels similar to my mom, he would definitely not be described as a gusher. I recall their reactions when announcing both my engagement and pregnancies. My mom was stuck to the ceiling, emoting all over the place, while my dad's feet were planted firmly on the ground as he said his congratulations. It is without a doubt that my parents' personalities complement each other, and that these differences have enhanced their relationship, which has always been loving and respectful. Despite all these differences, my parents have many qualities in common as well. The one that stands out above the others is their love and concern for their children and their grandchildren. Despite their busy lives, we have always been their main focal point. They have and continue to put us first. My parents have other traits in common. My parents both value their Jewish heritage and have passed the traditions down to us and now to their grandchildren. My mother has always upheld the importance of a Shabbat dinner where the children take part in lighting the candles and putting money in the tzedakah box. She has made this a special time for the family. Both my mom and dad have ensured that we've received a Jewish education and have impressed upon us the importance of such for our own children. My mom and dad are also parents who meet life's challenges with courage and persistence. They are both loyal, hardworking, kind, generous, and understanding. As you know, such traits are passed on down from generation to generation. I can attest to this, knowing that all of my grandparents had similar qualities and values. I therefore also know that deep down in the recesses of my own being lurks the same genetic material and all that this implies. Actually, I'm guessing that it lay dormant. As after so many years of inward searching and many attempts at becoming self-actualized, I just can't seem to locate it. On occasion, I have caught glimpses of this genetic material, but it appears to be elusive and difficult to hold on to. Mom, Dad, can I ask you something I've been wondering for so many years? Am I adopted? Serious though, I want to thank you for being the wonderful and caring parents and grandparents that you are. No words can express the depth of my love and gratitude for having both of you as my parents. You were always there to help me. You were always there to guide me. You were always there to laugh with me. You were always there to cry with me. But most important, you were always there to love me. Mom, Dad, thank you for standing by me then and now. I love and appreciate you forever. Thank you.